Black Op Radio, the voice of political conspiracy research. You're listening to Black Op Radio, the show NSA doesn't want you to hear. And now your hosts, Anita Langley and Len Osanic.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Black Op Radio, and this is number 45.
Number 45.
You're here with your host, Len Osanic. Hi, Len.
Hello.
And Anita Langley. And today we're going to be speaking to Gaeton Fonzi. And the date is July 26, 2001. Moving along there.
Right. Well, let's get right to it then.
Let's get right to it then.
Gaeton, are you on the line?
Yes, I am.
Great. Can you hear us okay?
How are you? Good, thank you.
Okay. Well, perhaps we could just start off by getting a little bit of background on you and let people know perhaps what happened to you that caused you to be on a path where you would be investigating the John Kennedy assassination.
Well, at the time, in the early 60s, I was working in Philadelphia for Philadelphia Magazine. This was one of the early city magazines at a time prior to most of them becoming style magazines or fashion magazines or good living magazines. They were still doing pretty good investigative stuff. And at the time of the Kennedy assassination, I was, of course, shocked as everyone else, but I came out of the Eisenhower era, and I believed in the government and didn't really question the fact or even raise the issue of whether or not the Warren Commission report would be not anything but valid. But at the time, there was a young lawyer in Philadelphia named Vincent Salandria. And there was a daily newspaper that was for the legal profession that was mostly a newspaper of record. It was called the Legal Intelligencer. And every once in a while, they would publish a front page article by a Philadelphia lawyer, usually on a legal issue. What happened was that one day I picked up the paper, and there was an article about written by Vincent Salandria, and it dealt with the Warren Commission report, which had just recently been released. And Salandria dealt with specifics in detail of the head hit and the shots fired in Dealey Plaza that day, which was in Philadelphia kind of a local story, because another Philadelphia attorney named Arlen Specter had taken leave of, as an assistant district attorney in Philadelphia and gone to Washington to work on the Warren Report. And it turned out that Specter, of course, was the one who devised, who was given credit for devising the single bullet theory. Well, I read Salandria's article on the Legal Intelligencer, and I didn't quite understand it. At that point, it was a little too complicated for me, but we were looking for some minor stories to do in the magazine, and I came across it, and I thought, said to the editor, I said, well, it might be a good story. Here's this Philadelphia attorney saying that the Warren Commission report was wrong. I don't know, you know, why he's saying it, but the guy is obviously some kind of nut, and it might be an interesting, colorful piece to go interview him and see what he's talking about. Well, that's exactly what happened. I went to talk and sat down with Vince Salandria. And I found, of course, that Vince Salandria was not a nut. He'd gotten interested in the Kennedy assassination, in the Warren reports, and in the Kennedy assassination, because the Warren Commission was holding secret hearings, and he didn't like that idea. And he began trying to follow the progress of the commission in through newspaper reports. And he got so into it that for a vacation, he took his family to Dallas and actually began looking at the scene and talking to people. So he was prepared when the Warren report came out to analyze it in detail. And he was specifically taken by the single bullet theory. And when he analyzed it, he decided it couldn't be true. But what Salandria told me was, besides all these details in a much simpler way than I was possible for me to comprehend without any kind of background in the case initially. But what he was basically saying was that so much that was in the Warren report was contradicted by the Warren Commission's own evidence that was in the 26 volumes of evidence that they released much later after the report. And he said the differences weren't just gray areas of interpretation, but black and white contradictions. And I found that hard to believe. I said that, you know, this is one of the most prestigious groups ever assembled, led by probably the most prestigious lawyer in the country, Chief Justice Earl Warren. You're saying some radical things here, Vince. He said, well, you know, just don't take my word for it. Here, I have an extra copy of the report. I have an extra copies of the 26 volumes of evidence. Take them home, study them, and see whether you agree with me or not. And I did. And I was just astounded to discover that Salandria was right. There were black and white contradictions between the volume, the report's conclusions and some of the evidence in certain areas. But I thought there has to be an explanation for some of these contradictions, even especially surrounding some of the areas of the single bullet theory. And I would go to Arlen Specter. I would go to the source because I knew Specter. And I had great admiration and respect for Specter because prior to him going to the Warren Commission, he had achieved quite a reputation in Philadelphia as a crusading assistant district attorney. He had quite bravely undertaken a case against the corrupt Teamsters Union, which was a pretty tough thing to do, politically and otherwise. But I thought, well, I'm going to go to Specter, and Arlen Specter will be able to resolve some of these discrepancies between the report and the evidence. And that's what I did. I went to Specter, and after two very long interviews with Specter, I came back with kind of numb with the idea that, with the realization that a report issued by our own government could not be true, and that Vince Salandria was right.
So did you find that our inspector was stonewalling you, or was he slipping you hints, or what tipped you off there?
What most struck me, I think, about Specter, as much as the substance of what he was talking about, was the fact that I had known Specter to be an extremely articulate attorney. He had been head of the Yale law debating team, as a matter of fact. But when I confronted him with certain pieces of evidence, especially, for instance, one of the things that struck me was the fact that the bullet hole in the back of Kennedy's jacket and shirt were something like 6 inches below the collar, which I asked Specter, how could you account for the bullet then coming out of his throat when it seemed to be below the level of the throat? And all Specter hemmed and hawed and got up, and I remember he came and stood behind me as I was sitting in the chair, and he said, hey, raise your arm. That's because Kennedy was waving to the crowd. Raise your arm. Wave your hand to the crowd. See how your jacket bunches up in the back? And I said, oh, still. It seems that it wouldn't have bunched up that much. And he said, well, basically in the end, he said, well, yeah, we did have some problems with that. And this is the kind of response I got from Specter that just floored me. I just couldn't believe that what his inability to answer contradictions in the Warren Commission's report.
So where did your journey go from there?
Well, I wrote an article for Philadelphia Magazine that basically said that it was hard to believe that the Warren Commission report was the truth and that Arlen Specter knew it. And was a very lengthy piece. And as a result of that piece, I eventually got involved with the Kennedy assassination by getting a call from Schweiker. What happened was that I had left Philadelphia Magazine, came to Florida, and began working down here, got involved in a Miami Magazine operation and Gold Coast Magazine operation up in Fort Lauderdale. And at that point, that was back in 72, I believe, that I came down to Florida. And it was shortly after the time, about a year or two later, that the public outcry for further investigation into both the Warren, into both the Kennedy assassination and the Martin Luther King assassination began to have some impact in Congress. And Senator Schweiker from Pennsylvania, who I had not known, began taking an interest in the Kennedy assassination. They, in fact, began looking into it himself and convinced Senator Frank Church, who was then running the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, to have him set up a separate subcommittee of the Intelligence Committee to look into the Kennedy assassination. And one of Schweiker's top aides had been a reporter in Philadelphia. I had known him casually. He worked for the Philadelphia Bulletin at the time. But when Schweiker took an interest in the Kennedy assassination, his aide, knowing I had come down to Florida and that a lot of the information they were coming up with concerned anti-Castro Cubans and pro-Castro Cubans based in the Miami area, I got a call from Schweiker's aide, and he said Schweiker needed some help. Would I have some time to check into it? Of course, I was. Ever since I had gotten to know some of the details of the Kennedy assassination, I was immensely interested in it. And I thought this was a tremendous opportunity to actually get involved. And it was. So I said, sure, I'd be glad to help him. How long do you think it would take? He said, we just need a few things checked out. It'll take you a couple of weeks. Well, I began uncovering things here, and before I knew it, I wound up working for government, first with Schweiker and then with the House Select Committee for 3 years on the Kennedy assassination.
Wow, that's a pretty good introduction to it then.
Yeah, 3 years.
and of all the things that you've found up, you know, we've got this article in the Washingtonian here. Len's kept it from November 1980, so that goes way back when. And it's a book within a magazine itself. I mean, I'm sure I've read shorter books, and it's just loaded with information about the journey that you went on and the interviews and the things that you found that were inconsistent. And one thing that kept coming up over and over again was misinformation and decoys that were being put in the path of investigators, you know, from intelligence agencies. Would you mind just going into that for a little bit? I thought that was quite fascinating.
Yeah, that's one of the things that immediately struck me. Because it was hard to believe after all these years that the cover-up could still be going on. And I'm talking back in the 80s after the committee was over, the House Select Committee. But early on, when I first began working for Schweiker, somehow the word got out. I began receiving calls from the soldiers of fortune type who had worked with the anti-Castro Cubans, mostly from them, on a regular basis, offering to help me, offering the right information to me. Frank Sturgis was one of my regular callers. Jerry Patrick Hemming was another. I was kept very, very busy. I think one of the most interesting most interesting incidents concerned a report that came into Schweiker from a man who had been the director of the Key West Airport. Now, my recollection isn't in such detail today, but Schweiker had a report from this fellow, and what this fellow said was that he had seen Oswald and Ruby waiting at the Key West Airport to board a Cubana Airlines flight to Cuba. This was in the early, in 61 or 2, I think he was saying. And they were with a group of young students who, I forget the name of the organization, but they were going to Cuba to help cut sugarcane. Ruby and Oswald was with them. And, you know, this is a guy who was a reputable businessman. He had been director of the airport, air operations at Key West. He was, at that point, he had retired, and not retired, but left to start his own business. He was running a major engine repair service in Key West, I believe it was. And so Schweiker got the report, and he sent me down there to check it out. Well, I spent an awful lot of time with this fellow, Alperado, I believe his name was. May be wrong about that. I have to check myself. But he took me to the spot. We started looking for records. We were going through old records at different places. I spent days with this guy. He would have detailed information that would only lead so far. We would only be able to check it out just prior to getting hard evidence for anything he was saying. We just couldn't do it. But I got friendly with him, and he invited me to his house for dinner, and I spent some time at his place of business. And we were chatting casually at one point, and I happened to notice sitting in a corner of his office behind the curtain with like a aerial camera housing. And we started talking about it because I was interested in photography at the time, and before I knew it, he's telling me about flying reconnaissance missions over Cuba to take photographs. And I said, well, who are you taking photographs from? And he just smiled. Well, you know. And then it just dawned on me. Here, after all this work, I'm dealing with an intelligence guy. And I couldn't believe that this was a kind of setup that took an awful lot of my time and diverted me from what could be valid areas of investigation. This is the kind of thing that was happening to me individually early on. And of course, as you may be well aware, of course, the House Committee itself, the House Select Committee on it, was very much diverted by and blocked by the agency many times over.
So you mentioned another individual who I thought was quite interesting, the widow of the founder of Time magazine.
Claire Booth Luce.
Right. She threw a wrench or two into the plot, too, didn't she?
She certainly did. And she came with Schweiker with the information that immediately after the assassination, she had been funding some of the boats for the anti-Castro Cubans and some of the operations. She was one of a group of wealthy people who were helping especially the an anti-Castro group called the DRE, the Directorio, student directorate, it was called, DRE, as it was known as. And she had been funding them and got to know these anti-Castro Cubans here in Miami and in New Orleans. And she reported to Schweiker that she had gotten a call the night after the assassination, the night of the assassination, I forget which, saying that the group had been infiltrated, had been tried to be infiltrated by Oswald. And I'm trying to remember the specific details, but she gave Schweiker a name, and I began looking for this guy. Of course, it later turned out that this was a totally phony name. We had some transcripts we did later discovered of her in a talk with CIA Director Colby at the time, in which she admitted she made up the name to give to Schweiker. But you know, one of the interesting spin-offs from that recently uncovered by Jeff Morley of the Washington Post was that the liaison that the CIA appointed to help the House Select Committee in its investigation and its acquiring of agency documents was a fellow named George Ioannidis. And what the agency did not tell the committee ever was that Ioannidis had been the agency liaison to the DRE and obviously was well aware, if not directly involved, in the misinformation that Luce was pouring out. And Ioannidis was the one who was actually funneling the agency funds to the DRE. And another interesting point was when we were looking for the agency handlers of these various anti-Castro Cuban groups, and I uncovered one of them, a fellow named Ross Crozier, who at one point handled the DRE prior to 1963. And then we were trying to find out who was his successor. The agency said the fellow couldn't be found. Agency told the committee. Well, the fellow who couldn't be found was right there working with the committee, and then the agency never let the committee know it.
Okay. Now, several of your fellow investigators are fired. Why?
That was the biggest farce of all. Supposedly they were fired, almost the whole investigative staff was fired. There was just a few of us left at the end because of a budget crunch, is what they told us. In the end, Blakey wound up giving Congress back money. But the real reason they were fired was because of the priorities, the ultimate priorities. At that point, Blakey declared that the investigative part of the committee's work was over, and that we would be preparing for the public hearings and for its ultimate priority, the final report. Getting out a final report was the priority, as he told us right from the beginning. Second priority was getting out a final report that looked good.
Now, if I can interrupt you for a minute, you said right from the beginning. But do you want to just go back? Were you there before Blakey was put in charge?
Yes, I was. I was hired by Dick Sprague, who was the first chief counsel, as you may recall.
Right, Dick Sprague.
I'm sorry?
Yeah, Dick Sprague?
Dick Sprague, right.
Yeah.
And, of course, what happened was, that I had known Sprague in Philadelphia, and he had heard about the work I had done for Schweiker, and he went to Schweiker and asked Schweiker for copies of my reports to him. And after he got the copies, he turned them over to Bob Tannenbaum, his deputy running the Kennedy side of the operation. And Tannenbaum then called me and asked me to come to work for the committee. Well, so when Sprague came down to Washington from Philadelphia, he came down with the intention of conducting an investigation, a real investigation, which was his mistake in Washington, actually, as it turned out. And he immediately ran into a lot of political problems with funding. And in retrospect, Sprague later told me, of course, that his main problem was coming up against the CIA. When he began delving into especially the Mexico City area, where CIA claimed to have had photographs, initially claimed to have photographs of Oswald and tape recordings, and then had all sorts of excuses for not having them. And then one of its chief operatives, David Phillips, testified before the committee that the tapes had been routinely destroyed, that with Oswald's voice on them, And it was later discovered, of course, that others had listened to the tape after Phillips said they had been destroyed. And Sprague was pressing him and pressing the agency to explain and come up with documents and material. And the agency said, well, before we go any further, we want you to sign a...
non-disclosure?
Yeah, a non-disclosure agreement. Sprague said, this is ridiculous. You don't sign a non-disclosure agreement with a subject that you're investigating. And that's what Sprague himself told me later. What eventually led to his demise, his political demise, and his being forced to resign from... chief counsel post. And that's when they got a guy who had experience in working with committees in Washington, knew what the priorities of congressional committees were, and
someone who they knew would take it the heat away from the agency.
Someone they knew that they could control, if not directly, certainly through the bureaucratic apparatus and through the awareness of what the dictates of a committee's operation should be.
It was interesting, though, that Blakey's specialty was dealing with organized crime and mob-related activities. It was almost like a given that he was going to search in those directions first if a connection had to be found in some way to a conspiracy.
No doubt about it. My first meeting with Blakey, I happened to be called up to Washington by Tannenbaum, and I was sitting in Tannenbaum's office, and Blakey came in. Blakey's an immensely likable guy, really intelligent, and he just sat down, put his feet up on the desk, and he started asking me what I was doing and what the areas in Miami that I would be covering. I started talking to him about it. It became obvious very quickly that his main interest was in organized crime and Traficante, Santos Traficante, of course, the major Florida organized crime connection. And he started talking about his work with Bobby Kennedy and about Traficante. And later, of course, it became pretty obvious. One of the interesting anecdotes that came up was when a few months later, they needed more assistant attorneys to begin the public hearings. They needed some good-looking, young, sharp guys who could play the television role of interrogators. And they hired a guy down here who I got to know pretty well. The young attorney was the assistant state attorney. I mean, a good guy, Jim McDonald. And Jim was telling me when Blakey called him to ask him to join the committee, he said, Blakey said, Jim, well, you know, it's pretty obvious who killed Kennedy. And Jim said, it is? He said, sure, you know who killed Kennedy. And Jim said, no, I don't. Well, who killed Kennedy? Like organized crime, of course. Jim later told me that story, and then began all fitting together where exactly Blakey was going. But I think it's difficult to divorce Blakey's assumption or a penchant to want to lay it on organized crime, because I think what Blakey also realized was that in doing so, this would be the area where he could compile the most documentation. And that was important, because you had to turn out a report and all the evidence in volume that looked impressive to the public and to the press later on. And Blakey was very well aware of this. It was pretty easy to make the mob the fall guy, as it were, because if he had gotten into opening doors at the agency, there was no end. Blakey would not be able to accept the committee's mandate to come out with a report within a specific amount of time. He would have been forced to demand more time and money from the committee because the CIA is not an agency you play around with when you know you have a limited amount of time and resources to deal with them. And the agency knows this very well.
Do you think it's possible that he might have, that Blakey might have genuinely believed that it was organized crime, maybe had a set of second eyelids towards anything that might have leaned towards the Intelligence Committee, or do you think he was actually perhaps following orders, in a sense?
I'm not sure he was following orders, but I think, again, Blakey knew what his priorities were, and his ultimate priority was to turn out a report on time, and this could have been done most efficiently and most effectively and most assuredly by setting up organized crime as the fall guy. You have to remember, though, also, the final report doesn't say organized crime killed Kennedy. I mean, Blakey was smart enough to cover his ass, as it were.
Yeah.
Even when it paints pictures of specific organized crime figures, such as Traficante being involved. The report rattles on, and then at the end says, of course, there's no evidence that Traficante or Marcello from New Orleans was involved in the assassination. No, what Blakey did was present a very restrained report as far as that goes, but when he presented it in a major press conference at its release in Washington, he himself said organized crime did it. The report doesn't say it. Blakey said it.
And I think the part of the report having that conclusion was due to the fact that some of the researchers were working almost behind his back and presented evidence to him in the final week that forced him to had to include it, and one of those areas would be the acoustical evidence, and also these other evidence that you have dug up, which you mentioned in your great article in the Washingtonian. You know, the last investigation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but at the end, in fact, at the very last minute, the acoustical evidence forced Blakey to have to commit to a conspiracy theory. And that's as far as it went, which was, I thought, absolutely ridiculous to leave the American people with the idea, with the announcement that, yeah, there was a conspiracy to kill President Kennedy, but this committee is now wrapping up and we're going home.
Yeah.
That was outrageous in itself.
Yeah, really. And as you say, you were a first-hand witness to this, that you already had the almost, if I'm not putting words in your mouth, but he had a conclusion, and his goal was to come up with this report. He was already working towards, here's our conclusion of our findings, even though we still have 6 months of evidence to dig up. We're going to start with this assumption and lead everything to that. So I end up with a report that I can hand somebody, and here's a final report, a conclusion of all our investigation. And it was in the early days, as you say, even when he just met him, he was already had the organized crime angle. That's correct?
Yes, absolutely. But you know, the main point here, and the main point I wanted to make in my book, was that the American people have been deceived now twice by first by the Warren Commission and now by the House Select Committee on Assassination, because in both instances they were formed and they were presented to the American people as entities that were going to conduct a thorough and honest investigation and complete investigation. And of course, the Warren Commission did not only conduct a not incomplete investigation, but did but produced a deceptive report. And the House Select Committee came nowhere near running a complete investigation, or for that matter, a comprehensive investigation. And that's a kind of deception. I think that's most galling to me personally, in terms of their disregard for the very basis of democracy, in terms of government being for the people and by the people.
If the case were reopened and you were in charge, what angles would you pursue today based on the research that you've done and the leads that you've dug up?
Well, today is even a long way down the road from when the House Select Committee wrapped up, and there's so many people no longer around. But I can only answer that question in terms of the areas that I myself were involved with. And, of course, that centered around the agency, and specifically the agency's relation to the anti-Castro Cuban groups here, and more specifically to the role of David Atlee Phillips, former chief of Western Hemisphere for the agency, and his associations, and his perjury before the committee, when he lied in terms of in relation to questions surrounding the fact that he was seen with Lee Harvey Oswald. Also, his relationship with the former chief of operations for the JM Wave Station here, a fellow named David Morales, who was major hitman for the agency down through the years. So these are the areas that I had become deeply involved in, and just barely scratched the surface as a result of the committee's restrictions.
Okay, well, since you did do some work that's really groundbreaking, and that's why we wanted to talk to you, we'd like to get on the record people who had firsthand knowledge, and those of us who weren't following the House Select Committee findings and whatever small sessions we've seen on videotape or we didn't see live on TV. It's great that you've taken time out to talk to us about it. So we're just interested in, for instance, the Blakey angle, and for instance, that they say Dick Sprague was, you know, in charge of doing a real investigation, and as soon as that was made known, he was removed rather quickly and unceremoniously. And do you keep in contact with Dick Sprague?
No, I haven't. I haven't spoken to Dick in quite a while. Of course, he's back in Philadelphia. Has been back in Philadelphia, and I haven't been involved in any further additional research on the Kennedy assassination. But of course, I try and keep up with what other researchers are doing today, and there's a lot of good work going on.
Yeah, even for instance, the Assassination Record and Review Board seems to be a watered-down effort again. But some people are really interested and excited on their findings, and yet, on the other hand, they come to the same kind of, the same old story that, well, we've done our job, and here's what we found. We've got a few boxes of records open, but still there's a lot more opened, and nobody's giving any carte blanche into records. And that can only mean one thing, that they point to involvement of government agencies, if not the instigation of the removal of Jack Kennedy. And that is the real kind of troubling irony, that it's one thing for them to be part of the cover-up, but another thing for them to be actually the originator, sole perpetrator of this. And for people to investigate it, it's an awful lot of trouble. And if you're lucky to get some congressmen together to fund some kind of another investigational, like the church committee or some other of these things, you're going to be presented with a whole organized effort of disinformation campaign, such as you have mentioned. And as time goes on, people are passing away, so there's not likely that there's going to be any any real legal action happen, but for people interested in history that are writing, Noel Twyman, for one, Bloody Treason is a book that has been just, I don't know, reprinted. It was out in 95, I guess, or later, but it's a pretty good book. You had some contact with Noel Twyman.
Yes, I have. You know, what you're talking about, Len, is something that I addressed a few years ago when in the conference in Dallas, and that is the issue of what the so-called mystery of the Kennedy assassination. And what I suggested was that it's time to go beyond that, because there is no real mystery to the Kennedy assassination today. We know the truth. We know the truth. The truth was known almost immediately when there was a barrage of gunfire. A barrage of gunfire in Dealey Plaza. And the truth was known to us in the government's immediate designation of the assassin. And then the government's immediate extermination of that designated assassin. You know, I find that I happened to be looking over some of the material that was on the Prouty website, and the letters he wrote to the Garrison, I believe it was, to General Krulak. One of the things of he talks about, of course, is that security vacuum in Dallas that was specifically ordered to take place. And it's somewhere, I have a copy here, it says, one of the things he says, it is the cover-up that gives away the location of the plotters. This is one of the biggest cover-up operations in history, and one of the longest running, yet it is still airtight. This can only be done from a location in very close to the seat of power. And that's the answer to the Kennedy assassination. I think Prouty had it down right from the beginning.
Unfortunately, he's just passed away. He's no longer with us, but he did do his fair share of writing. We commend him for all that he has provided and that I put together in that CD-ROM, but we still run a web page for him. Others like Jim Garrison, and you mentioned Vince Salandria, people who have done a good effort in trying to point out the truth, no matter how much opposition there is to it, that this corruption in government is right in front of us and it almost being flaunted. And to the point that whenever there is with the AARB or the House Select Committee on Assassinations, that they have placed agents inside there to make sure that these things don't... they want to find out what researchers have found out and how they can best counter that. And even Oliver Stone's film, I have to commend that. Some people complain about it, but it's just another example of how this kind of thing happens. And like Fletch said, the real answer is that you have to have a complete power to keep the trial from happening. So think of the power that has to be there to continually keep anyone from having any public trial about this, you know, murder of John Kennedy and even Officer Tippit, and to keep people in Texas from even having the opportunity to bring that up. So the seat of power is very high, and with a well-funded agency to continue a disinformation campaign, such as the Gerald Posners and others who continually put out well-funded books and publicize the campaign trails, and every time there's something on CNN or somewhere else, they always call him up as a quote expert. That just goes to, you know, underscore the determination that they don't want this information going out just because of where it leads.
Look, there are many things discovered by the JFK assassination which are relevant to today, I think, and one of the things you mentioned in the article in the Washingtonian, I thought was particularly relevant in that it shows how seriously we've all, you know, our cities all over the place have been infiltrated by front organizations. And one thing in particular that I thought that you mentioned was interesting was this JM wave organization, a huge CIA installation at the University of Miami, and you mentioned a huge list of businesses that were being run and helping to fund this, and a person does have to wonder, and Colonel Prouty did actually talk about this in some degree. He mentioned something like over 600 different CIA headquarters way back when in the early days, and I can't imagine how that might have blossomed in the meantime. But that's almost unfathomable when you're talking about everything from newspapers and print shops to delis to, I mean, you just name it. It could make a sane person a little paranoid.
Yeah, well, this is Miami. This is what the government has created here in Miami. Another country, actually, is what they've done. And the CIA, because of them coming in so early with so much force and so much power and so many resources. It molded the character of the city. You know, what you were saying and what Len was saying reminded me of when I got back into the Kennedy assassination investigation with Schweiker. I thought what would be a good idea was to go back to Philadelphia and sit down again with Vince Salandria and see what his feeling were at the time and perhaps get some direction from him. And the interesting thing was that in that interim period, Salandria had pretty much dropped out of researching the Kennedy assassination, and he was doing very little talking about it anymore. And I asked him about it when I got there, and if you don't mind, I think this is really sums it up. I'd like to read what he said when I asked him about it.
By all means, yeah.
His feeling. Do we have some time?
Sure, sure.
Yeah. It's just a paragraph that he's to explain his. His disillusionment, as it were. And he said, "I'm afraid we were misled. All the critics, myself included, were misled very early. I see that now. We spent too much time and effort analyzing the details of the assassination, when all the time it was obvious. It was blatantly obvious that it was a conspiracy. Don't you think that the men who killed Kennedy had the means to do it in the most sophisticated and subtle way? They chose not to. Instead, they picked a shooting gallery that was Dealey Plaza and did it in the most barbarous and openly arrogant way. The cover story was transparent and designed not to hold, to fall apart at the slightest scrutiny. The forces that killed Kennedy wanted the message clear. We are in control, and no one, not the president, nor Congress, nor any elected official, no one can do anything about it. It was a message to the people that their government was powerless. And the people eventually got the message. Consider what has happened since the Kennedy assassination. People see government today as unresponsive to their needs, yet the budget power of the military and intelligence establishment have increased tremendously." It's ironic how prescient that Salandria was at that point and how relevant what he said then, a couple of decades ago almost, how relevant it is today.
Yeah, that shows some real insight into the nature of the problem.
I agree.
As you may know, I used to correspond with Vince, and I had the utmost admiration for him until for some reason, I don't know what was going on, but the news group that had all these different people's opinions in there, it seemed to be just a continuous argument of... Mm. And I called him a support group for Tourette syndrome one time. And finally, I had to drop out because, you know, I was interested to learn and I was interested to offer tidbits, but it never seemed to go anywhere. And that's one reason, too, that if anybody doesn't investigate, you've got to find like-minded people who are up to speed with things. And there's a lot of people that suffer kind of a burnout, too, from, like, the way Vince had mentioned in that letter you mentioned, that you know, is blatantly obvious. And so what are you going to do about it? Nothing, right?
Yeah, and a lot of people get lost arguing over the details, which I think that was a very good point of what you read there, too, in that why even argue over the details when it's got to be glaringly obvious certain things fall into place and, you know, there's not much point in wasting time on arguing. And I suppose it serves a purpose, though, if people are divided and whatnot. But the comments, though, about letting the open assassination, that is a really a serious point to think about, because as you said, as he said, the technology exists to, you know, pretty much do away with a person rather discreetly. It could be a heart attack, it could be anything. So in a sense, it's just that bit more frightening to think that it could be that bold. And, you know, I mean, does that make the people much more helpless? I guess it's a fair prediction if it looks like people have largely rolled over, because a lot of people who would have said, nah, it's just a bunch of conspiracy theories once upon a time, will now go, oh, yeah, of course the government did it. So what? You know, what are you going to do about it? They just throw up their arms. It's acceptable. That wouldn't have been acceptable if we were talking about Nazi Germany, or, you know, I shouldn't maybe draw those comparisons, but maybe I should. Yeah, in any sense, I think it's worth noting that, anyway.
I think, anyway, people that are joined together because of the Internet nowadays and students coming up are very interested in finding out that things are not reported as they seem, and that on CNN or in the newspaper you could find out that things are actually contrary, and a cover story being purported over the people. So this is kind of a good foundation for it. Well, if you don't believe that the government's lying to you, take a look at this case, the John F. Kennedy assassination. The more you look into it, it'll be right in front of your face that, like they said in the movie, black is white and white is black. Well, look, we wanted to talk to you about a few more of your personal interests and things that you can add to kind of our interview. And we'd like to know if you have, I sent you a few preliminary questions there. There's some people that you had interviewed over the course of time, and we just like maybe your comment and impression on them. And one of them you mentioned was David Morales. Would you care to offer an opinion on...
Well, David Morales, when I discovered him, was dead, which is one of the interesting things, because his gravestone out in Arizona says simply he was an Army sergeant. As if he were nobody, he rose to one of the highest ranks in the agency. And of course, he was the closest associate to David Phillips. It was Morales who, one drunken night with some close friends, one of whom happened to mention John F. Kennedy, Morales literally almost hit the ceiling and began cursing Kennedy and yelling about what a wimp Kennedy was, and talking about how he had worked in the Bay of Pigs and how he had to watch all his men die. He had recruited and trained and got wiped out because of Kennedy. And he was half drunk, but he was ranting and raging and jumping up and down, and finally he sat down, according to two eyewitnesses who were there and told me. Morales just sat down and said, well, we took care of that son of a bitch, didn't we? And of course, when we checked Morales' background, he was one of the key covert operators in the agency who was given assassination assignments. And so he became one of the most interesting characters we came across afterwards, as we were talking about areas that we never got around to exploring.
And what about Ted Shackley?
Well, Shackley ran the JM Wave station down here, and Shackley was not at all forthcoming. In fact, right after Blakey came on, Blakey's whole intention when he first came onto the committee was to work amiably with the CIA and be nice to them, as he put it, so that they would, in retrospect, he naively thought they would voluntarily begin cooperating with us as far as their innermost documents went. And so I happened to be up in Washington again when Blakey came in and said, we have an interview with Shackley, let's go over and talk to them, because it was an informal thing. Blakey, myself, and the deputy to the Kennedy assassination, Cornwell, went over to see Shackley, and I had, at that point, not as much detailed information about the operation of JMWave or what was going on down there, but I did manage to ask Shackley a few questions, and one of Shackley said a couple of things that we later discovered were outright lies. And one of the things he said was that the immediately after the Kennedy assassination, they had no real ability to the agency had no real ability to penetrate Castro's inner circle, so they really couldn't do anything in terms of finding out whether or not Castro may have been involved. Of course, we later discovered that they did have penetration into Castro's inner circle in the form of a guy named Cubella, Amlash. But it was interesting to me at that point that Shackley would lie directly to Blakey's face. And Blakey represented Congress. He represented the representatives of the people, as it were. And Shackley was David Morales' immediate boss in the JMWave station. He was the guy in charge. So he was, to me, always been one of the more interesting characters who we know probably one-tenth of what there is to know about him.
Right, but if the agency had a role in this, he would be one of the key figures.
Yeah, I would assume he would be very, very important.
What about Jerry Hemming?
Jerry's an incredible guy. One of the smartest guys I know, and one of the guys who you can spend hours with, and he will regale you with fascinating stories and minute detail. And you never know, and there's no way of ever telling what part of what he's saying is valid and what isn't. Is it just Jerry Patrick Hemming? A likable and very, very intelligent guy.
Then you mentioned that that other fellow that you were helping your investigation, he was seemed forthcoming in helping to you until you found out that he was actually agency as well. The fellow you mentioned, where you discovered his photographic equipment.
Yeah, the camera.
Guy down in Key West.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
But as I say, early on, guys like Sturgis and Hemming quickly presented themselves to me to be. Be as helpful as they could, and a lot of what went on was taking me around in circles a lot. Frank Sturgis, of course, was the most colorful guy, and the one who was toughest to pin down. Just he'd call me at night and spend hours on the phone with me, giving me leads, every one of which usually went nowhere, or went to a Castro Did It
right.
Foundation.
Okay, what about Jake Esterline?
Never really got anywhere in terms of tracking him down at this point. At that point, I should say, and placing him, you know, it was just among a long list of people that we never got to. And we never got to because we were other priorities were imposed upon us.
I got a couple more names I wanted to mention to you. What about Ed Lansdale?
Yeah, again, he wasn't really in the area, as it were, for me to follow up on him, but I was intrigued by Fletcher Prouty's identification of him in that tramp photo.
Right, and the fact that he was in charge of Mongoose.
Yeah, yeah.
So he had to be part of that inner circle. And what intrigued me about Bloody Treason by Noel Twyman, which you had some work with, was the fact that the Get Castro was kind of a code for Get Kennedy, and everybody on the team knew they were just saying, we're getting ready, we're going to get Castro. And I think one of his conclusions, it was kind of just a code word that that whole little circle had turned on Kennedy and were, you know, for, probably a year planning his removal. Any comment on that? Have you read the book, Bloody Treason, by Noel Twyman?
Yeah, I have. It's an encyclopedic presentation. Noel did an incredible job of putting a huge amount of information in that book. But again, I had some disagreement with Noel in terms of the degree to which he was accepting some information and information that I thought I couldn't quite accept.
No, and that's a fair assessment. And just to stick up for him a little bit, I've heard through third parties that he has now learned quite a bit more in the last year or two that he had when he's written his book. And the problem is he feels like doing an update to it or a revision or just a part two, but he says he's just too old and he's at some point got to retire. I was lucky enough to see him speak in Encinitas, California, in one of the last, lectures that he did publicly. That's why I flew down there to see him. And like you say, the book is almost encyclopedic, and I urge everyone to go through it, and whether you agree with everything or not, just read it and use it a good base. For myself, I have some small objections about his characterizations of Colonel Prouty's theories and angles on things, which he seems to soften up as time goes by. But as well with Fletcher and as well with McNamara, he's based an awful lot on one or two interviews, and it had taken me years to get close enough to Fletcher that he would open up on key issues, and that I'd prove myself by doing the proper legwork and research and coming up to his level of knowing exactly what was going on, that I could speak with him about it. And he felt that, okay, I will elevate the conversation a little higher here and lift the lid and kind of expose a little more what I've done now that you prove that you're not just going to go, you're going to handle it responsibly, the information and things like that. So I think that it's very riveting to read the chapter on his interview with Bob McNamara, but I almost didn't agree with any of it, and I thought, well, how can you accept his answer? You should have had more rebuttal to it. But on the same token, if you're a guest in someone's home and you're doing an interview and you want to let them get their side of the story out and then maybe go back and follow up, well, how can you say this when obviously these other points prove they're wrong? And you found that out probably with your investigations of people where they report one thing to you, right, like you said, lying to Blakey's face. So either people have just decided to live with some of these answers and say, well, that's what he said, we'll leave it at that. And if they don't, they just end the investigation so that you don't have a time to do any more follow-up. And that's a shame, but it's been all very interesting, this angle of history. I have found it that. Now, what are you doing these days? As you mentioned, you after the House of Comedian assassinations, you kind of downplayed your interest in this, but just from arm's length?
I had to just get on. I'm a freelance writer, basically, and I've done some major investigative pieces, and one of the things I'm working on now is a book involving an FBI informant. a guy who had committed a number of murders, the national swindler, whom the FBI continued to work with and use as an informer, even though they knew that he was committed these murders. It's a complicated story that...
Well, that's good. So you've got something that's going to be coming out in the next few months?
Not in the next few months. Who knows?
Oh, it's a work in progress.
Well, it's yeah. I mean, it was based on articles I had written for magazines down here and worked with it several years ago on the story for the New York newspapers. In fact, the major political scandals up there broke out of that. And in Chicago.
Now, when you mentioned I hate to cut you off there. When you mentioned you've been writing for various newspapers, had you come up against opposition to your articles on the Kennedy assassination? Did you find that you had submitted some to one editor or another, and they just turned it down because of the...
No, I've never had, because I haven't really written that much about the Kennedy assassination. I wrote the original article on Arnold Specter Warren Commission report for Philadelphia Magazine, and then after the committee, I wrote the article for the Washingtonian, and of course, I expanded that into the book, The Last Investigation.
Yeah. Now, did you have the pleasure to talk to Arlen Specter after your article came out?
While I was still in Philadelphia and working for Philadelphia Magazine, I did another piece, but in nothing further about the Kennedy assassination. He wouldn't talk to me any
comment either way. Then
further about that, and the interesting thing was that he didn't rebut anything in terms of he just wouldn't answer other reporters' questions that came later.
So in one way, he didn't dispute anything. Any criticism you had of him, he just bit his lip and said, "Well, I guess you're right about that."
It wasn't so much criticism as just.
No, and I didn't mean it that way, but I meant
the
critique.
In terms of what was just explaining the what I thought was the evidence, and what was interesting, Arlen couldn't deny what he had told me or deny his inability to answer the questions because I had tape recorded everything, for one thing. And so he knew that. And he couldn't actually rebut anything he himself said had told me.
Well, if you ever come across those tapes, let me know, and we'll post one of those up on the internet. It'd be interesting listening. But back to the few people that I did want to mention and just talk to you about. Had you met Jim Garrison personally?
Yeah, I did. I met Jim when I was first started working with Schweiker, and then I was the initial liaison with Jim to the investigators who were working in the New Orleans area. So, but because I was working out of Miami, I didn't do any kind of follow-up with him in New Orleans. But he was certainly one of the most remarkable guys I've ever met. Impressive. Impressive in his, what I thought was his straightforward honesty. I know he takes a lot of criticism and he took a lot of criticism for some of the what others would term wild and crazy things he said. But when you talk to him one-on-one, he was very convincing and very valid, I thought, in some of his conclusions. He opened up an area that I thought was a valid area of investigation that... that I thought produced information that really needs additional follow-up also.
And what was that?
Well, the whole ferry business and the business of the sighting of Oswald in what was that town outside of New Orleans, and with his when Oswald supposedly showed up at the voter registration drive in the name of the town slipped my mind then.
Yeah, I was just about to say it. It slipped my mind too.
Yeah.
But we all know what you're talking about. I think Jim Garrison has got to be the number one man who was the only one who actually got a court trial in the assassination, and he came the closest. And I guess did the most that I think anyone could do. It's almost superhuman, his effort and the obstacles he had to overcome, and disinformation campaigns, and take a strong person to stand up to that.
Mm-hmm.
Even his interview on Johnny Carson's show, have you ever heard that?
I don't recall.
Oh, it's unbelievable the treatment that Johnny Carson gave him. I'll have to mail you a cassette tape of that. You won't believe it.
Really?
Yeah, it's somebody must have prepped Johnny for a couple of days on that. And it was just a one-sided effort of character assassination. Yeah, but he held up rather well. And it just goes to show you never know where these other campaigns are coming from.
Mm-hmm.
But he's somebody that I very much admired. And the more I read about him, the more I wanted to read about him. And I think like people like him and Fletcher and Mabe Russell,
mm-hmm.
some of these researchers are, you know, just doing it as a hobby or part-time. There's a lot we owe them for, just for getting some things out in the record that later on, a few years from now, other people who are interested in it will dig up facts and put things together.
Yeah, I hope you're right. I hope that was one of the motivations in my doing my book, and Washingtonian piece first, but then the book, because I felt that I had no idea I was going to do anything after I left the committee, but when I began hearing that the committee report would be presented as representing a valid and complete investigation, I just felt that for history's sake, I had to reveal at least what I knew about what was going on inside of the committee at the time, and what the investigation, or non-investigation, as it more likely should be called, what was happening.
Now, putting it in that perspective, what was the most single important piece of information that was left out from the public eye that you came across in that 1978 House Select Committee on Assassinations group?
Well, I don't think you can really point it down, boil it down to one.
Well, one that you recall or something, you know, one, a couple.
I think, again, I have to go back only to those areas that I was personally involved with, and to me, what was most disturbing was the committee's report's distortion of the testimony of David Phillips and Antonio Visciana in its final report. In order to avoid the conclusion that when Visciana said that he had seen David Atlee Phillips with Oswald, in order to avoid that conclusion, the committee decided it would say that they didn't believe either Phillips or Visciana, because Phillips had denied that Visciana had been introduced to him by name. And that he committed perjury before the committee when he did that, before Congress when he did that, because I was there and another witness was there. We could have proven that he was lying. But Blakey didn't want to follow up on that at all. Didn't want to irritate the CIA. And so they had to handle it in a distorted way. And then in the final report, that's one of the items that I think was outrageously distorted, their conclusions on that.
We have a question here submitted by Gregory Burnham with regards to Ruth Payne. Apparently she gave some conflicting testimony about when she first met the Oswalds. Do you know anything about that?
No, I don't, because I wasn't involved in investigating Ruth Payne. But what's interesting, and as an example of how the committee was working, was that Ruth Payne was one of the individuals that slipped through the cracks of the investigation. Incredibly enough, as important a person as she was, and it just reveals the political priorities of the investigation and how the substance of the investigation was secondary to political priorities. Ruth Payne was never interviewed by the committee.
Right. I think the question was that it was brought up in an article written by Mike Malone from the Philadelphia Magazine.
And, Mike Malone?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you worked with him?
No, I knew Mike.
Oh, you just knew him?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
He worked, he was at the magazine. He just prior to my leaving the magazine, he had...
So, but he did good work in this...
he didn't do much on the Kennedy assassination. He did a couple of pieces involving people in the Philadelphia area who were associated with the Kennedy case and the Kennedy investigation. But I don't specifically recall
that article.
Yeah, that article.
Fair enough. Well, look, I think we're winding up with all the questions that we had, and we wanted to get listeners out there to hear you in firsthand have some scope of what was going on at the House Select Committee and the reason for some of its flawed conclusions or even non-reported conclusions. Is there anything that that we haven't got to that you'd like to bring up or anything that we've forgot to?
Not specifically. I think what most of the American people have to realize is that there has not yet been a valid, complete, and comprehensive investigation of the Kennedy assassination, and that's to me it's outrageous. And you know, for years and years now, I keep wondering why the American people aren't as outraged as I am about the thing, and right from the beginning when I discovered, as it were, that Vince Landrieu was right, that the Warren Commission report was a blatant lie, as I was shocked to find out after my interview with Spector, I wondered where is the media? Where are the newspapers on this story? Why isn't this being blasted across the front pages of every major newspaper in the country? To me, this is the blackest mark on American journalism, and remains so. I guess that's the point, one of the main points I still harp upon.
Actually, just on your last point there, it's kind of funny because in your comment, where is the media, you mentioned that on the board of directors of the Association of Former Intelligence Officers, was the very lady who is the widow of the founder of Time magazine, and perhaps that sort of sums it up a little bit.
Yeah, exactly. We discovered later Claire Booth Luce herself was very much involved with the Retired Intelligence Officers Association.
It's been wonderful having your insights contributed to the program here, and our listeners are going to benefit greatly from hearing you. It's good to hear that you're doing a book, and what a great subject, too, because nothing more timely. I think there are a lot of people that are suffering as a result of testimony being given from people who perhaps have something to gain by not necessarily being honest and spinning themselves and stuff. So it'll be very interesting to read your book. So do you have a projection? I guess I got the impression that it's not going to be, you're reluctant to give a schedule. Okay. Well,
my pleasure.
Please let us know when the book is done, and we'll try and keep in touch with you then. And thank you so much for being on the program.
Thank you very much. Enjoyed it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Well, everybody, that was Black Op Radio number 45, I was going to say 25, they're 45 for July 6th, year 2001. And you've been here, that was Gaeton Fonzi.
Yeah.
And
that was great that he, I think we were almost an hour and a half again, eh?
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, an hour and 20 some odd minutes. So, Len, it's been great talking to you.
Yeah, I never did, every time I see that Blakey on TV or whatever, I never did trust him.
Yeah, I know.
Just something about...
I got the impression that you're not that fond of Blakey, but Soviet. And thanks, everybody, for joining us and for keeping us motivated and trying to keep us honest. Thanks a lot.
Keep those emails coming.
Yeah, please.
Listening to Black Op Radio, broadcasting weekly from the Fiasco Brothers Recording Studio in Vancouver, Canada. You're listening to the Fiasco Brothers Radio Network. If you believe there's more to the JFK assassination and the mystery surrounding the CIA and its covert operations, you're not alone. Meet the man Oliver Stone called X in the epic motion picture JFK. Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty comes forward with never-before-seen or heard documentation and information about JFK, the Vietnam War, the CIA, and more on a brand new CD-ROM. The collected works of Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty is an incredible offer not to be missed. For a limited time only, find the answers surrounding these issues and more with the collected works of Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty. Call now at area code 604-525-4167. That's area code 604-525-4167. Or visit the Colonel Prouty reference site on the World Wide Web, the collected works of Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty.